So today we are going to be discuss about the limitations of valence bond theory. Valence bond theory was accepted by the chemist for 20 years, from 1930 to 1950. VBT was very famous theory. Okay, because valence bond theory explain satisfactorily the bonding in complexes. On the basis of the valence bond theory, the bond between the metal and the ligand, it is coordinate covalent bond. So in those days, coordination compounds were interpreted only in terms of valence bond theory. So everyone apply the valence bond theory to the coordination compounds. So there are certain merits of the valence bond theory. There are certain advantages of the valence bond theory. So first of all, let us see what are the advantages of the valence bond theory. First of all, the theory is very simple, simplicity of the theory. Second one, its strength in treating the structure and magnetic properties of various complexes. We know that valence bond theory satisfactorily explain the magnetic properties of the various complexes. The complexes are said to be diamagnetic when all the electrons are paired. The complexes are said to be paramagnetic if one of the electron is unpaired. So this explanation was given by the valence bond theory. Then also the valence bond theory gives the correlation of stereochemistry and magnetic properties. In case of nickel second complexes, and that is also one of the success of the valence bond theory. In case of the nickel second complexes, that is possible. But even though valence bond theory explains so many things, there are number of shortcomings or limitations in the valence bond theory. There are certain limitations in the valence bond theory. Shortcomings, drawbacks in the valence bond theory. So in this lecture, I would like to discuss about the limitations of valence bond theory. So let us going to be discuss the limitations of the valence bond theory. Limitations of the valence bond theory. So first limitation of the valence bond theory, I would like to share with you. See on the screen. VB theory does not explain satisfactorily why some complexes of metal ion in a particular oxidation state are low spin, that is inner orbital complex, while some other complexes of the same metal ion in the same oxidation state are high spin, outer orbital complex. Okay, or whether a four coordinated will be tetrahedral or square planar. This is the serious drawback of the valence bond theory. Valence bond theory has not the proper answer to explain this. The valence bond theory does not explain satisfactorily why some complexes of the metal ion in a particular oxidation state are low spin, while some other complexes of the same metal ion in the same oxidation state are high spin. So let us take the example to explain this. Okay. Let us take the example to explain this. See here, in this complex ion, CONH3 6, three plus complex ion, hexamine cobalt third ion. So this complex, it is a low spin complex. The arrangement in this complex will be like this. I would like to show here why it is a low spin complex. You can see the arrangement in this complex. Okay, low spin complex it is. So 3d orbital, the arrangement it will be like this, then 4s orbital and 4p orbital. So you can see here, this is 3D, 4S, 4P. So there are six vacant orbitals undergoes hybridization. And these are the electrons donated by the six ammonia molecules. So hybridization, it is D2SP3. All the electrons are paired. Okay. So this is a low spin complex and diamagnetic. The oxidation state of the metal, it is 3+. But in a complex COF6, the same central metal ion is involved. Oxidation state of the metal is also same, 3+. But this complex is a high spin complex. This complex is a high spin complex. The same central metal ion, same oxidation state, same coordination number, only the ligands are different. So this is a high spin complex. We know the arrangement of this complex. High spin complex means maximum number of the unpaired electrons. So we can show the arrangement in this way here. Okay. 1, 2, 3, 4. Electrons remains unpaired. 3D orbital, then 4S, then 4P. And outer D orbitals are used in the bonding here. Outer D orbitals. Okay. So this is 4S, 4P and 4D. This is outer orbital complex. Outer orbital complex. Oxidation state of the metal is same. So why that metal ion shows this type of the arrangement, sp3d2 configuration. And this is the high spin complex here. Four unpaired electrons are here. And it is outer D orbital complex. This is the outer D orbital complex. Outer D orbital complex. And CONS36, it is a inner D orbital complex. So valence bond theory has not proper explanation about this. Okay. The same metal ions, coordination number is same, oxidation state is same. So in one complex, it shows low spin complex. It is a low spin complex, inner orbital complex. And here it is outer orbital complex. So this is the drawback of the valence bond theory. Valence bond theory could not explain this satisfactorily. Why this will be? What is the reason? Okay. So valence bond theory does not having the proper explanation. Okay. See, CONS36, it is a diamagnetic. COF6 is paramagnetic. Both complexes have cobalt in 3+ oxidation state. You can take another example here. CuNS3, 4 2+. Copper 2+ was supposed to undergo sp3d hybridization. Just as Zn2+ in ZnNS3 4 2- ZnNS3 4 2+. But X-ray crystallographic experiment shows that it has square planar geometry. Square planar geometry. Okay. So this explanation does not given by the valence bond theory. One more example I would like to give this related the limitation of the valence bond theory. You can see here. Okay. See, NiCN4, this complex, we know that. NiCl4 first, 2-. It is a tetrahedral complex. Geometry of the complex, it is tetrahedral. Oxidation state of the nickel metal, it is 2+ here. Coordination number, it is 4 here. And if you take the same metal in NiCN4, okay, in NiCN4, the same nickel 2+ ion, nickel 2+, coordination number is also same, but it is having square planar geometry. It is having square planar geometry. So valence bond theory could not explain this. The same metal ion shows tetrahedral geometry here, tetrahedral complex. Hybridization, it is sp3 here. Hybridization, it is here dsp2. So this is the limitation of the valence bond theory. Valence bond theory could not give the proper answer about this. So very serious drawback in the valence bond theory. That is the first drawback. Okay. Second, VBT fails to explain why only in certain complexes electrons get paired up, giving diamagnetic property, while in other electrons remain unpaired, giving paramagnetic property. We have taken the example of CONH3+ and COF6-. In case of CONH3+, pairing of the electron is takes place. I would like to show here. 1 minute. See here. Okay. CONH3+. Here pairing of the electron is takes place. You can see the arrangement. All the electrons are paired. While the same metal ion, COF6. See. These electrons are not paired up. These electrons remain unpaired. And this is outer orbital complex, COF6-. Okay. So the same metal ion, same oxidation state, same coordination number. In one arrangement, there is a pairing of the electrons takes place. But in this case, there is a no pairing of electrons. In 3D orbitals, the electrons remain unpaired. So valence bond theory could not give the proper answer about this type of the arrangement. Okay. So that is also the drawback of the valence bond theory. Valence bond theory fails to explain why only in certain complexes electrons get paired up. And it is having the diamagnetic property. Okay. Then third drawback, serious drawback. The serious shortcomings of the valence bond theory is that it fails to interpret or predict spectral properties of the complexes. Spectral or color properties of the complexes. Valence bond theory could not explain about this. Most of the complexes of the transition metal ions are colored. It does not explain why transition metal ions are colored, why their complexes are colored. For example, okay, if we take the example of this complex, see, CuNH3-4, this complex, CuNH3-4-2+, this is a blue colored complex. Okay, valence bond theory could not explain about this, why it is having the blue color. Then if we take another example, NiCl4, this complex, it is having supposed to be green color. Valence bond theory could not explain about this. So valence bond theory could not interpret the spectral properties of the complexes. Complexes are showing the spectra, okay? But spectral properties are not explained by the valence bond theory. So this is also the drawback of the valence bond theory. Then fourth, VB theory fails to explain certain geometries like tetragonal and distorted octahedral geometries. Valence bond theory only explains tetrahedral, square planar, octahedral geometries. But another geometries like tetragonal and distorted octahedral geometries could not explain by the valence bond theory. Some complexes are showing such geometries. Okay. Then VB theory cannot explain or predict relative energies of different stereoisomers. That is the fifth limitation of the valence bond theory. Okay. So these are the serious limitations of the valence bond theory, shortcomings of the valence bond theory. No doubt valence bond theory explains so many good things, but there are certain limitations are involved in the valence bond theory. Valence bond theory has not any proper answer about this. okay? So that is the limitations of the valence bond theory. Valence bond theory could not explain why some complexes are diamagnetic, why some complexes are paramagnetic, why there is a pairing of the electron takes place, why not the same central metal ion undergoes pairing of the electron, why that complexity is outer d orbital complex, why this complex of that same metal ion, it is a inner d orbital complex. Okay, so these are the certain limitations of the valence bond theory. Okay, now let us going to be discuss the applications of the coordination compounds. We has been discuss each and everything about the coordination compounds. What are coordination compounds? What are the characteristics of the complex ion? What is the ligand? What are the types of the ligand? What is Warner coordination theory, valence bond theory? Number of topics we have discussed. And finally, I would like to discuss here the applications of the valence bond theory. Applications of the coordination compounds. Applications of the coordination compounds. So first application, it is analytical application. Analytical application. Almost all qualitative analysis schemes involve complex ion formation. Qualitative analysis, you know, qualitative and quantitative analysis. So in qualitative analysis, there is a formation of the complex ion. Okay. Complexes are usually formed to keep a metal ion in solution or to dissolve a precipitate and brings the metal ion back into the solution. For example, complexes are usually formed to keep a metal ion in a solution or to dissolve a precipitate and to bring the metal ion back into the solution. For example, silver chloride dissolves on addition of ammonia solution and formed this complex, this. Okay. So it indicates that there is a presence of silver ions in the solution. Complexes are usually formed to keep a metal ion in a solution or to dissolve a precipitate to bring the metal ion back into the solution. Okay. So silver chloride, when treated with ammonia, there is a formation of this complex ion. This complex ion can be formed there. So this is the first application in the qualitative analysis scheme. Second application here, formation of complexes with characteristically colored solutions or precipitates is used for the detection of metal ions in solution. For example, copper 2 plus ion can be detected in a solution by dark blue colored solution it forms on addition of ammonia. Suppose that you are given a solution and it is asked to you, find out whether copper 2 plus ion is present or not present. Okay, so what can you do? We have to take the solution of the copper 2 plus ion in a test tube. Then we have to add the ammonia solution. If this dark blue color complex is formed, that indicates that copper 2 plus ion is present in the solution. That is a qualitative test for the copper 2 plus ion. Okay, so this complex will be formed there. Dark blue color complex is formed. It indicates that the solution will contain copper 2 plus ion. Okay. Formation of complexes with colored solutions or precipitate. Either there is a formation of the precipitate or solution. It is used for the detection of the metal ions in the solution. So in a solution, whether copper 2 plus ion is present or not present, it can be detected by addition of ammonia molecule. So there is a formation of this dark blue color complex of CuNH3 4 2 plus. So this is the test for the copper 2 plus ion, qualitative test for the copper 2 plus ion. Now nickel 2 plus can be identified by scarlet red precipitate in the solution of the nickel 2 plus ion. For example, suppose that you are given nickel 2 plus ion and it is asked to you, where the nickel 2 plus ion is present or not present. So what can you do? You have to take the nickel 2 plus ion solution. Okay, unknown solution, unknown quantity. You don't know whether nickel 2 plus ion is there or not there. What can you do? You have to just add this solution, dimethyl glyoxime. Okay, in presence of ammonia. Okay, so how we can do this? Test nickel 2 plus ion, add some ammonia and dimethyl glyoxime, DMG. There is a formation of scarlet red precipitate, means red precipitate, dark colored precipitate, red colored precipitate is formed. And that is a complex. Which complex? This NIDMG twice. This complex is formed there. Dimethyl glyoxime. Okay. Scarlet red precipitate is formed. It indicates the presence of the nickel 2 plus ion. So this is the qualitative test for the nickel also. Okay, qualitative test for the nickel also. Then third analytical application. Some cations are separated on the basis of stability of their complexes. We can separate the cations from each other. For example, copper 2 plus and cadmium 2 plus ions form cyanide complexes like this. Suppose that your solution contain copper 2 plus and cadmium 2 plus ion and treated with cyanide ion. There is a formation of this complex, tetracyanocuprate second and tetracyanocadmate second ion with excess of potassium cyanide solution. Cadmium complex is less stable on passing S2S gas. If we are passing the S2S gas here, cadmium precipitate as cadmium sulfide, leaving copper complex in the solution. Okay. It means that we can separate the cadmium from copper. How? You can see here. Very simple process. Some cations are separated on the basis of their stability. Okay. Suppose that you are given a solution of copper 2 plus and cadmium 2 plus. Okay, in your solution, suppose that we have take the beaker here, and in a beaker, it will contain two ions, copper 2 plus and cadmium 2 plus ion. And now it is asked to you to separate copper and cadmium from each other. Okay, so what you can do? In this solution, first of all, you have to add the reagent, that is potassium cyanide. Okay, so reaction will be takes place here between potassium cyanide and these ions. What happens? There is a formation of the this complex CuCN4 2 minus, and this CdCN4 2 minus. Now this complex is more stable complex, highly stable, and this is very less stable. Less stable means existing for the shorter time. Okay, now we want to separate the cadmium from this. So what we can do? Later on we have to add in this solution, pass the S2S gas here. What happens? The cadmium, it is a less stable complex. This complex, cyano complex of cadmium, it is less stable. So this cadmium get combined with sulfide ions of the S2S gas, and this precipitate, cadmium sulfide precipitate, is formed here. Okay, black precipitate, you can see precipitate, and this is the soluble complex. Copper is not separated from the cyano ligand here, but cadmium is separated from the cyano ligand here, and this precipitate is formed. And later on, what we can do? We can separate, we can filter the solution. This cadmium can be separated from this copper. In this way, cadmium and copper are separated. Okay, so analytical application, by first of all, we have to form the complex. We are discussing here about the application of the coordination compounds. So here complex is formed. Later on, ions, cations are separated from each other. Okay, so see here, this is the application we have discussed here. कैडमियम प्रेसिपिटेट एज कैडमियम सल्फाइड लिविंग कॉपर कॉम्प्लेक्स इन अ सॉल्यूशन। देन सेकंड एप्लीकेशन, ईडीटीए इज यूज्ड फॉर द एस्टिमेशन ऑफ मेनी कटायंस लाइक मैग्नीशियम, कैल्शियम एंड एल्यूमिनियम बाय वॉल्यूमेट्रिक टाइट्रेशन। व्हाट इज ईडीटीए? ईडीटीए इट इज अ पॉलीडेंटेट लिगैंड, इथिलीन डायमाइन टेट्राएसिटिक एसिड, इट इज अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट रिएजेंट। ईडीटीए इट इज अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट रिएजेंट, ओके। ईडीटीए इथिलीन डायमाइन टेट्राएसिटिक एसिड, इट इज अ हेक्साडेंटेट लिगैंड, हेक्साडेंटेट, ओके, इट इज अ हेक्साडेंटेट लिगैंड। सो दिस ईडीटीए कैन बी यूज्ड टू फॉर्म कॉम्प्लेक्सेस विथ मेटल आयंस, फॉर एग्जाम्पल कैल्शियम 2+, मैग्नीशियम 2+, ओके। सो दीज मेटल आयंस आर फॉर्मिंग द कॉम्प्लेक्सेस विद द ईडीटीए। सो दिस कॉम्प्लेक्स विल बी फॉर्म हियर, कैल्शियम ईडीटीए कॉम्प्लेक्स, वेन यू आर एडिंग द ईडीटीए सोल्यूशन इन द कैल्शियम 2+ आयन, वेन यू आर एडिंग द ईडीटीए सोल्यूशन इन द मैग्नीशियम 2+ आयन, दिस कॉम्प्लेक्स विल बी फॉर्म्ड देयर, ओके। सो दिस इज ऑल्सो द इम्पॉर्टेंट एप्लीकेशन ऑफ द ईडीटीए, बिकॉज एस्टिमेशन ऑफ मेनी कटायंस इज पॉसिबल। Suppose that you are given a solution of the magnesium 2+ iron and it is asked to you, how much quantity of the magnesium 2+ iron is present in the solution? So you can perform this volumetric titration. How you can perform this volumetric titration? You have to take the solution of the magnesium 2+ iron in a conical flask, fill the burette with EDTA solution and titrating. What happens? At the end point of the titration, I would like to give the example this in more detail, okay, how the estimation of magnesium is possible with the help of the EDTA titration. See here, okay, suppose that you are given a solution of the magnesium 2+ iron, okay, and it is asked to you estimate the amount of the magnesium, the amount of magnesium present in the given solution, okay. How you can do this experiment? Very simple it is. Present in the given solution, you have to take the solution in the conical flask, magnesium 2+ ion is here, okay, solution of the magnesium 2+ ion, fill the burette with EDTA. EDTA it is a hexadentate ligand, okay, EDTA solution, and titrate the magnesium ion solution with EDTA by using indicator we are using here EBT, erythrome black tea, okay. And at the end point of the titration, magnesium EDTA complex is formed. And on the basis of the burette reading, you can estimate the amount of the magnesium present in the given solution volumetrically. So this experiment is already given in your syllabus. Then next application, many organic chelating agents like dimethyl glyoxime, orthophenanthroline are used in colorimetry. Many organic chelating agents are used and there is a formation of the complex. Complex will be formed there. Then many metals can be separated by solvent extraction technique using chelating agents. We can separate the many metal ions by the formation of the complex with chelating agents like acetyl acetone, furfuron, etc. Copper 2+ and Fe3+ can be separated using acetyl acetone. Okay, this is the experimental process. Then the very important application that is given here last, total hardness of water can be estimated by titrating hard water with EDTA. This is also the experiment given in your syllabus. Total hardness of water can be estimated by titrating hard water with EDTA. Okay, so later on I will explain this very important application. We can determine the hardness of water. Okay. So these are the analytical applications. Industrial applications are also there of the coordination compounds. Which are the industrial applications? Dissolved salts of iron in water causes many ill effects. which can be prevented adding EDTA. EDTA is a strong chelating agent. It forms a chelate with Fe3+. Okay, and the iron can be removed from this. Okay, so EDTA is acts as a chelating agent there. That structure it is given here. This is the structure. Fe-EDTA complex can be formed. Okay, so Fe3+ is present in water. It is tightly imprisoned by EDTA, and hence it is harmless. Otherwise, iron it is dangerous also. Okay, but we are using the EDTA there. Then it can be prevented by adding EDTA. Okay, dissolved salts of iron in water. In water, suppose such it will be there, and if we are adding the EDTA, then EDTA will remove the iron from that water. That is the industrial application. Photography, in that photography also there is a formation of the complex. Okay, so many applications are there related to the coordination compounds. Okay, number of applications are given belong to the coordination compounds. Biological applications are there. Biological applications, industrial applications, and analytical applications. So number of applications are there for the coordination compounds.